and cabinet, because you're gonna be getting kind of physical moving stuff around these tables. You don't want to go knocking over a dye bottle.
Totally agree.
The loudest sound you'll ever hear in the shop is this, followed by a stunned silence.
Now, do you not have something that you put your bottles in to support them so they don't fall
at,
over?
At the shop, I've got a couple of plaster molds that we've made by taking a plastic jug, cutting it off, and we wrap one of these up in some saran, and we fill it with plaster and shove that in and let it set. Then when you take it out later on, hold the saran out, because somebody can drop it in, it's not gonna fall over. One of the handier things you can have, if you don't want to make up a stand just for a bottle of dye, is use a coffee cup. It's really quite, even though it's circular, it's about as high as it is wide. So you're not apt to knock over a coffee cup quite as readily. It's fairly heavy. Well, maybe you are.
I find I take little blocks of wood and glue cat cans, cat food like Friskies.
Oh yeah.
That's just the right size to take one of these.
One of your bottles.
Yeah. Yep. And then it's got a little block of wood under it, and you're not going to tip it over.
I'm going to go with something
a little bit darker because this is
going to
be very apparent. You just notice this color is really thinned out. So this is dark chocolate. So you notice I'm using the same sponge. It doesn't really matter. I'm using a darker color, so I'm going right on top. So it's not going to really come into it. So I'm squeezing up all that liquid dye. There's already one a lot here. I really try to do this without getting much in the way of streaks. Now there's a lot of fly vice in this. It's South American hide, so they should see a lot of stuff coming out. As you add a little bit more pigment, your color is going to change. And I've got two colors in the sponge now, so we will have kind of a blended effect. And just because I started with one color doesn't mean I have to do it all in the same color. I can, as I press harder and the sponge compresses more, I can start adding different colors for different effects.
So instead of adding more dye to the sponge, you just pick the dye up that's in the cardboard.
I can. There's still quite a bit of pigment here. And as you do this, it also has the effect, because you've got a damp sponge, as these things are brand new, they're I'm not sure what they're loaded with. It's not water, because these things don't fog up. But it's soft. And when they've sat out for a while, they dry out really hard. And that's better to block dye with, the harder sponge, because you're going to get it flatter.
So obviously you could dye that a lighter color first and let it dry and then come back to it and do this over top of it?
Yes, you could saturation dye it first and then block dye over for more of a rustic antique. That's dark chocolate. You see, it's nowhere near as dark as if I had just taken a dauber or a piece of sheepskin and hit it with it. But it brings out more of the natural characteristics in the leather. And
one
personally
of the
like a piece of leather that looks like leather. If it's perfect finish, well, it might as well be vinyl.
One of the things you'll find if you're doing a large piece is the hide's going to be have different amounts of liquor in it, and different the surface is going to be different, and you're trying to get the same color over the whole hide. So you do your saturation dyeing with dauber or sheepskin and everything, and you notice a light spot, dark spot, light spot. You try and hit one spot with more, and it just won't go in. There's no way that it's saturated already. The color is different in that area. You can take the sponge with the same color, and because you're just coloring the very top, even with the same color, it helps to even the color over the whole hide. So you get to put the same color on that way, on top of the saturation dye, the same color, and you can blend it in more, and the color stays on top of the hide rather than going right in.
Soaking in.
Yeah, and so it can make a whole, especially on a big piece, can make it very, or help to even it out.
Anytime you start scaling up, things get more complicated when you're doing stuff by hand. Trying to do something like a large photo album or something like that and get an even dye tone across the whole thing. It's not, there are techniques to do with saturation dye by wetting it down with alcohol first, methyl hydrate. You don't want it soaking wet, but if you get it damp, there's already methyl hydrate in there. The dyes are alcohol based. So when I apply it, it's not grabbing it out of my applicator, it's soaking it right in. It's going to give me more time to move it around. The leather will actually look wet, and that's fine. The more important thing is you get an even dye color. The whole thing is going to be even. Then you simply let it dry, buff it, and then do some conditioning, bring some flexibility back into it.
And one of the things that Al goes through when he's doing saturation dyeing is he uses dilute dye first. So he's got his surface ready. He goes with a dilutant or alcohol. So he's not using full strength dye right off the bat. Then he can bring it up slowly by adding intensifying color, and he gets a more even condition over the whole hump.
So just because I've gone over this with the block dye, doesn't mean that it's not going to take straight dye right through it if I want to. I don't necessarily have to start with that base color. I can add color on top of this. This is a piece of sheep's wool. Because of the textured finish, it's going to get down into the nooks and crannies that the sponge doesn't do. We like to use this sort of stuff for applying everything, dyes, finishes, antiques.
Now, do you leave them hairy or do you trim them down?
I'll usually trim it back, depends on the skin. Now that's going to mute everything down. This is quite a thinned out brown. I made this up when I was trying to blend in color for matching up another project. Again, if you don't know how it was mixed initially, you're kind of shooting in the dark to trying to match something out. But if you start light, you can always apply and apply and apply and apply, try to get down to the tone you want. You should let it dry, because the wet bench, of course, has a color of its own. You don't know what that color is going to be until it dries up. But I've still got all the characters. Still got all the characters. Like,
where's our quiet sign?
Sounded like someone cocking a gun. That's why you reacted the way you did.
Some noise in there.
It's like a golf tournament.
Sometimes people will take a piece of edge leather and they want to dye it black. And black can be frustrating because you go over it once and it dries up and you get blue areas and streaks and stuff like that. It has a great deal to do with the amount of tan liquor that's in the hide, how brown it is to start with. Stolman used to take a black belt, he'd dye it blue first, or dark, dark brown, and then he'd put a black dye on top. I always found the color would show through. So part of that has to do with the brightness of the hide. If it's a really bright veg when you start, it's not going to get a really great solid black. So we'll use a topical finish like bag coat, which is tinted, and we'll rub it over. It soaks into the surface, so you gain more depth to your color, and it makes a black just absolutely jet black.
That's
and
black bag.
Black bag coat, right.
That goes on before or after. After.
Yep.
Bag coat's a finish.
Yeah, I know that. So.
Actually, it's probably an acrylic finish.
I really couldn't tell you.
Probably, you're right. Yeah.
So it's like what David was doing with acrylic, just to wash it over and make it pop.
Yeah. You'll get more streaks when you're doing dyeing and finishing, especially finishing, if you're using a sponge to apply it with. If you use a sheep's wool, because of all the tiny little fibers that are there, you can actually keep working it as it dries, and it'll get a beautiful satin finish to it. The bag coat will actually leave it without any shine at all. You can get to a semi-gloss and leave it, and it'll pretty much stay a semi-gloss. Or you can keep working with your sheepskin and your bag coat until it's dried on surface or almost dry.
Now, do you carry black bag coat at the store?
Yes.
It's available.
It is.
Yeah.
And that's the only place.
Yeah.
Tandy,
yes.
Tandy doesn't sell it.
No, it's Tandy says their line of products, and they carry some Phoebe's products, but it's more limited since they're trying to promote their products.
Yeah. Do you sell bag coat? Cam?
No.
Now we have tried taking different finishes and tinting them as well, adding a little bit of dye. It doesn't really work all that well. Some of the products can be mixed together, but usually the results are not really what you're hoping for. So if I was doing like a large piece like that, I would simply keep working around, step back, turn it, look at it from a different angle. Do I have a light area? Do I have a dark area? If this was a square book front, I might try to work around my edges to darken my edges while block dyeing in order to get more of a sunburst effect. Again, we're trying to bring out dimension in the surface of leather. So if you've got a tooled section that you really want to highlight in that way, then kind of frame it in a little bit. When you do a book cover and it's flat, you're going to think about working all the way around the outside edge. Remember that book's folded in half. So figure out where the spine's going to be and kind of shade in around that and shade in around the back. So you have kind of a back and a front sunburst.
And give the same impression as using an airbrush.
Very much so. I've used airbrushes for applying colors before. And one of the things that I found is when you're shooting alcohol-based dye, these are penetrating dyes, and if it's not getting into the leather itself to any kind of real depth, it's not a really reliable color. Airbrushing is half of that is, the atomized mist is actually drying before it gets to your product. So it might look wet on the surface when you're spraying it.
Too heavy.
It's actually too light.
Too light.
Too light. I've had three-dimensional pieces like masks where I've airbrushed them all in, and then when I hit a clear coat to it, all that dye on the surface just runs completely down.
Did you have that problem?
About the fellow that was helping him, Terry, at my shop,
mm-hmm.
he's a professional airbrush artist.
Yeah.
And it has a lot to do with your air pressure setting and how you mix your liquids.
It may be the fact that I'm just not all that good with an airbrush, too.
Yeah.
But I've also seen airbrush projects that if they get bumped or scratched, and even just lightly, the color, the veg color is showing right through that.
Yeah, I know. I was frustrated because when I got my airbrush, I tried to do it, and it was exactly what you said. It looked great, but I could wipe it off because it atomized yeah. and dried yeah. before it hit.
It also depends on air pressure. More pressure, it dries more.
Yeah, we just have the old style compressors, so we really don't have a regulation for that pressure.
No, you have to.
And there are airbrushes that we have are not very high quality, so. Yeah, they're passé, but I don't know if that means anything anymore.
Well, they dual action or single action. Oh, I don't get into that. That's
dual, yeah.
Dual action. Yes.
So, airbrushing is a great technique because you can get some really neat detail work without having hard lines or rub lines and streaks and stuff like that. But it takes a lot of practice, and you really have to be using it in a ventilated area. We did a belt at the shop one time that we sprayed red because we wanted a really nice red, and we were blowing our noses red for like 4 days because it was just that much.
And there's a mist on everything.
Oh yeah.
And you don't think to until you pick something up, you can see the ring where it yeah. was.
Like David was saying yesterday, when you're with the dye stuff and having little crumbs of dye stuff all over the place, a rime will usually form at the tops of these jars. Sometimes it's been knocked over too many times, so you get a crust going around the outside. When you open that jar, don't do it over your project.
Mm-hmm. No. Yes.
And again, if you start with a fresh piece of paper when you're doing each job, then at least you've got a clean surface to work under, because little crumbs will be in the shop forever, and you'll be... occasionally, just for kind of a guard against that, I'll wash my table down at the shop with alcohol from time to time, and as soon as you pour the alcohol, and you pour it on, you'll see little color beams showing up all over the place. And if you get a piece of that, a crumb of that could stick to a project. And next stage, all of a sudden, you get this spot of blue showing up in the middle of your brown book or your binder, or whatever you're doing. You know, you don't want to get that color in there.
If you use an alcohol-based top coat,
so spin around.
Sometimes you can make your colors bleed just because you're putting alcohol on top of it if they're not well soaked in. So oftentimes, if you're using a water-based color, and the water-based colors are often not very soluble or insoluble in alcohol. So when you put an alcohol-based top coat on, the colors remain frozen. So sometimes you make a test piece with your top coat to make sure you're not turning your dye work muddy. So you want to make sure it goes in and the colors are frozen where you want them to be.
Just gonna grab that shiny bit and see if it'll...
I usually use newspaper.
That's a good idea.
None. But dye on top of the newspaper. So.
Purple.
Burgundy?
It seems to just be everywhere. Little crystals of purple.
Especially when you spill them. Yeah.
Ultimately, you become a lot more confident when you're coloring. If you actually do play with this stuff, start mixing it up, start thinning it out, and start practicing on scraps. The more practice you can get, the more confident you'll be. Don't spend 20 hours doing a project and then just right out of the bottle, just go at it. Make sure that you know what you're doing, you practice it, you know the color you're gonna get. Practice on the same scraps, the same material of what you're doing, so you're confident when you go at it. We do stuff with dye all the time, so it's really quite second nature.
And it's a matter of being brave. Like yesterday, I cringed when he took that beautiful piece of buffalo and cut it up and used it
yeah.
for a sample.
He has a whole roll of it. He's good.
Well, yeah, but...
To be said, it's a whole roll.
Now, Jimmy and I were actually talking about that at breakfast. There are people who are not afraid to get at and do something yeah. and screw it up. And then try and fix it afterwards, and there's the rest of us that are so tentative about it I'll sit and look at something for a month and a half before I go near it. And then I screw it up anyway, so I may as well have done it in the first place.
I'm sure there's a lot of you have done stuff out there, like done a black belt with two-liter stamping into it, and you want to paint those lettering afterwards. You have a real hard time because it's a black belt, and you're trying to get white letters or red letters or something like that. So I'll use this block dyeing technique sometimes to, if I want to do, say, a red background around the lettering and then a black on top, I'll actually take some dye and hand paint it into all my letters, and then block dye black over top. So you get all the letters outlined in bright red with a black belt.
Yep.
If you apply the liquid dye with a brush, saturated in that area, you want to try to keep it as close to the letter as possible. If you kind of go outside the lines as you were, and block dye over top of it, you will still see some red going around there, because there's not as much pigment going in on a block dye as when you're saturation dye. And the, usually I'll be standing up to do this, I'm just feeling lazy right now. Get some brown coming out of this one.
You know, if I did what David did yesterday, I would have been worse shape with my back leaning over. That's why he has a table that's nice and high, so he's actually standing straight up. Your table's much higher than this too. I would think it'd work, isn't it?
43 inches.
Yeah.
Which is exactly the same height of my bench at home. Just get used to being at the same height all the
yeah.
time. Andy's is 42 or 43 inches, or a little bit higher. It's quite high. But Andy doesn't do any dyeing of stuff at all. All of his leather stuff that he does is all done with finished leather. So, just doesn't do it. So, that's not going to be the same color block dyed as it is saturation dye because of the lack of pigment that's in there. But as this antiques, it oxidizes, exposed to ultraviolet, all this light veg color, that's going to deepen down. You're not going to see it in the long run. You can hurry that along with a bit of oil in order to mute it so it's not quite so brilliant. And the overall color is going to change anyway as this oxidizes. So that's great for brown tones, but if you're doing something like a light green or something like that, that leather is going to change color in behind. And the dyes are transparent. So if your substrate darkens, your overall color darkens. You take the alcohol-based dyes and really thin them out in order to get pastel colors, they're actually more susceptible to fading than not because there's a heck of a lot less pigment involved, and UV will just strip it right out. Some colors are harder to fix than others. Red pigment is extremely difficult. You could dye something in purple, and the red pigments will actually fade out and leave blue behind. And after like a matter of 3 weeks, just under overhead lights, it'll be blue. It won't be purple anymore. And then blue fades out.
Blue is very unstable. I did a covered a Matisse bottle in Skyver. I sponge dyed it with the turquoise dye. It looked mm-hmm. great at the time. It looked like stone almost.
Mm-hmm.
Within a year, that had gone just to natural Skyver, a little bit darker brown than it was to start with, but the bottom of the bottle was still the blue that it had been, you know. So yeah, the blue had all gone out of it.
Using a spray finish with the UV inhibitor is really going to help to keep your colors, but it's only going to help so long. If there's no finish put onto it at all, it will actually fade very quickly. So having some kind of a good hard finish on there is going to be protecting for it.
Now, since you've mentioned it, may I ask you, do you oil your products before you dye?
No.
Why?
Why would I?
I would ask the same question because I do. If I'm using Phoebing's alcohol-based dyes, if I'm using an oil-based dye, I don't.
Well, I think if you oiled your project before you started and you went out with anything water-based, you'd have rather inconsistent coloring because wherever the oil is not going to allow a full penetration of water-based product.
Water-based, no.
No, there are people who religiously just say, I have to oil it first before I dye it. How many people here say that to me?
I've learned by mistake not to put oil on and stuff.
So I'm one of those that doesn't put oil on anything, but if you look at Sheridan Carving, mm-hmm. they always oil it first.
Yep.
Before, and it just seems to be that when you've carved, you have to oil. And I don't like oil. That's personal preference.
Mm-hmm.
But I was going to ask your opinion.
Of you're saying that if you dye it, you have to oil it anyway. So why would you oil it before and oil it afterwards?
You don't have to oil it.
You don't have to.
You don't have to. Because you said it would dry out.
Okay, so.
If you're saturation dyeing, I'd oil it afterwards because it's stripped of natural oils out of the skin. This type of dyeing, it's not penetrating anywhere near deep enough to affect the surface of the leather.
So does the oil not, like, this is what I was taught, this is years ago, especially if I was just doing a solid color. Oil at first, like if I was using mahogany dye, because I found that it sat on the surface of the leather a lot, but by putting the oil on first, it opened up the pores a little bit for it to be a more uniform color of mahogany.
No, I'd probably stick with what David did and work with the belt damp if I was going to do that. Because having an open grain is certainly more beneficial for dye penetration, and alcohol should go right in. But I usually use something like black straight out of the bottle.
Yeah.
You know, because what's the point of thinning it out? You want black.
So what you're saying is wet your leather first, or dampen your leather first versus oiling it?
No.
Dampen it with water versus the oil.
I would probably dampen down with the methyl hydrate first, because you use a lot less dye, and you've got more time to move it around.
Methyl hydrate is an alcohol, isn't it?
It is.
And if you're using an alcohol-based dye, then use alcohol, not oil.
The methyl hydrate is what you want to buy. Don't use rubbing alcohol. It's only 70% alcohol.
It's 90% you need.
99.9.
Is that,
where do you get that?
What's the stuff we use?
Isopropanol.
Isopropanol? Is that the same stuff?
That's 99% stuff.
Yeah. The isopropanol is not as active as the methyl hydrate when you add it to your dye. So some of the dyes are not that soluble in isopropanol, where they are more soluble in methyl hydrate. The best, of course, is ethyl alcohol, but don't get your whiskey involved in that.
I've done a lot of stamping, like the water takes the oil out of the leather, right?
It does.
So I use the pure neatsfoot oil, just go over it lightly and to put some oil back in, let it dry overnight, then stain it.
Yeah, neatsfoot oil is a nice one for conditioning, especially if you have it warm. Because it's so thin, it will readily migrate through the leather. I tend to steer people away from conditioning leather products with neatsfoot because it's too easy to overdo it, and you can get a piece which basically soaks up so much oil it becomes like a dish rag and you can squeeze the oil out of it. Most people don't want anything to be greasy. The real downside in the end is that fat, because it's mostly white hog grease is what they use to make neatsfoot oil, it's going to get rancid later on, and once it starts to turn it can have a detrimental effect on the proteins that make it up, the leather. So you're better to go with a paste-based product, like mink oil paste, where, because of its thickness, you're not going to overdo it when it comes to conditioning. With the oil, you can just keep putting another coat, another coat, another coat, another coat, and then it becomes a dish rag. So.
One of the projects we were doing at Colin and Tammy's place, did the boxes up, put the color on, and decided, okay, coloring's done, let's oil them up, get them back to a better feel. And then Tammy said, oh, I want to add more color now. We took the sprayer to dampen the leather, and wherever the water hit that oil, it created a sort of a dye ring. You know what happens when you have a soak in one place where it kind of goes? Went starburst. I said, that's an amazing effect, so you may want to try that. Brown it up, oil it, take your water sprayer and just, and you'll see, it'll just change the whole surface. I was
amazed. Stayed that, way?
No, she didn't want it to stay that way. So she took the block dye and then
in her mind,
she
put
a finish over that and it would stay that way.
So I don't. We didn't leave it long
so
enough to
play
that far.
Enough. You're gonna experiment. Let us know.
Yeah. I said,
panic
quick,
set in.
Yeah. Get the sponge and start smoothing it out again.
And I know you get tired of hearing it, but you've got to practice with it. I had a chap come into the shop who was doing carbon and tooling workshop, and he'd made himself this beautiful photo album. And he was going to use a gel antique, because it's like an all-in-one kind of product to antique. And he used the dark brown, and when he finished the inside of the binder, it was so dark brown you couldn't see the carbon. It was almost black. And I suggest to use dyes and then an antique in order to bring out a highlight effect. Especially on the front cover where it was heavily tooled. He probably had 20 hours into it. So he took the product and he laid it on and went at it with sheep's wool and rubbed it around, and it turned this lovely shade of dark green. So it's not always reliable as to what effect you're going to get. And I've had problems with a lot of all-in-one type stuff where it's supposed to be a dye finish, an antique all-in-one, where, you know, the bottle says prairie tan and you do a piece and it turns out prairie tan, the next piece turns green. It gets clumpy in the bottle. I'm not sure what's happening chemically in there, but if it's not reliable, I'm not gonna go with it. I'm gonna go with what I know. So always practice on your pieces first. Make sure your stuff's well mixed. Make sure it hasn't settled down to the bottom. It's a lot of these things. These dyes are liquid pigment, but other dyes are powder based. And if they've sat in the shelf, like the garnet stuff was powder based, was it?
Yes, I believe it was.
I know we used to get Lion Brand black dye, and it was powder based, and you get a lot of dye stuff sitting on top. And if you left it sit too long, all the hard stuff go to the bottom. And have a jar of black alcohol, but you'd have all the dye stuff in the bottom. So you gotta make sure it's mixed up. Well, I wanted you to put on your gloves and give you all a sponge and grab a hunk of leather.
Now, one of the things to remember, if you are doing a project, you put your hours in and you've got it all carved out and it looks great, except you got a fingernail mark over here, or you put a tool on it, or you scratched it on the way through, taking it out of the bin, and then you block dye it, and all of a sudden you'll find all the errors will come up. You'll see all the marks on the leather.
Of course, part of the joy of using this technique is what I'm doing is I have a box.
Careful.
I've got you a piece of leather.
Just do come around and not go under the carpet. Yeah. It's very nice.
And they say the shoes remain breathable. So they, even though they are just like David did, puts them on in a thin enough film, it's got the color saturation, but still permeable.
So where did he get those from?
Was that from?
Because he got those from Poland.
From where?
Poland. Poland. Notices.
Oh, okay.
So it's red. And green. I don't know if they're made in Poland, but they're made in Poland.
Red. If you like gold, Ceres or the craft stores have gold paint.
Yeah, you've tried it, Kim?
Yeah, that's what I did on my wall, my red wall, gold and silver.
Oh, nice.
And then I just went over the top to tone it down. I did an antique over top.
Yellow one first.
And wiped that, well, before I did that, obviously I used a satin sheen to seal it up.
Yeah, I actually did.
And just toned it down first.
And then I put green on where I wanted to be green, and then I put red on where I wanted to be red, because yellow is actually in between green and red. So you mix yellow with red, and if you're orange, you mix yellow with green, and you do yellow green.
Very fine washes of white acrylic underneath, and then mold with your gold acrylic.